Canoe engineering has a long history. It actually dates back to the late 19th century, before Duke University was Duke University. When there was only Trinity College, there was engineering within Trinity College in the late 1890s. And I think there were a grand total of two engineering professors at that point. But the College of Engineering per se was started in 1939.
James B. Duke, when he founded the university, he had very specific ideas about his university. He wanted it to be not a theoretical university. He wanted it to be about the solving of actual problems and the improvement of the actual quality of human life. If you read the endowment indenture, this concept of using the powers of the human mind to improve the lot of human beings is just written all over it. And it seems to me that Pratt is just a perfect example of that.
Duke was a beautiful place. It was small enough that I could easily get to know people in the medical school, in arts and sciences, and see where engineering might be able to work with them. I thought, this is going to be fun.
After 75 years, the school has come a tremendously long way in a fairly short period of time. If you think about it, the school was born during the World War II era, where a lot of established schools were hitting their prime in terms of contributing wartime technology, and Duke was just in its infancy. Within a couple of decades, Duke fielded one of the first biomedical engineering departments in the country and became a leader in terms of engineering in that direction, and since then has grown the strength of its other departments to be equally strong leaders of the engineering field.
So when I arrived here in 1999, it was called the School of Engineering at Duke University. One day, it was about 3 weeks into my tenure, and I got called into the president's office. They said, we want to tell you the exciting news is that one alumnus, Ed Pratt, who grew up and built Pfizer into a mega research pharmaceutical powerhouse, wanted to give back to the school that he felt had enabled his success, and that we were going to, in honor of him, name it the Pratt School of Engineering. You know, I think some of the things that I'm most proud of when I look back, of course, is this beautiful facility, the Fitzpatrick Center. I think more than that is the kind of interdisciplinary programs that grew out of that, like photonics, like biologically inspired materials and material systems, bioengineering and energy in the environment. That enabled us to recruit the very best faculty in the country to come here because they'd be part of something that wasn't going on anywhere else.
The areas where Duke is well known for a collaborative innovation, global health, energy studies, things like that. We're able to do those things the way we do them because we have an engineering component and because our engineers are good partners with our doctors, with our environmental scientists, with people in arts and sciences. It really is a story of the parts adding up to a whole that's more than the sum of the parts.
Duke engineering students are special. They're exceptionally curious and have an exceptional desire to give back. When you put those two things together, what you see is an extraordinary amount of engagement among our students and the school.
Devices for People with Disabilities is a senior design course at Duke for biomedical engineering majors. In this course, we're paired with a client to address a challenge that he or she faces in their everyday life. We worked with a high school junior. He really loves to DJ. He loves music. It's something he's very passionate about. The problem he faces is he has Morquio syndrome.
I live the same way as everybody else does. It's just been a little bit harder for me because I can't walk as well as everybody else.
We wanted to come up with this solution for him to transport all of his heavy DJ equipment to a gig, and it's kind of an all-in-one setup, so he can do it all by himself.
Using this cart, it makes me a lot more independent. A lot of the other DJs, their setups will take a 5 to 10 person crew. This one, it's only me and maybe somebody else.
There are many different fields you can go into and ways that you can help people, but I know moving forward that engineering is something I want to do. It's something I'm very passionate about, and that's how I like to help people.
We offer standing engineering fundamentals in the classroom, but I think what really sets us apart is the rich array of co-curricular and extracurricular activities that complement that. These are opportunities to engage society in ways that you just can't do in the classroom. The Grand Challenge Scholars Program is something that began here at Duke, along with our partners at USC and Olin College. And it was based on the idea of what was needed in education to prepare students to address the grand challenges for engineering for the 21st century. And what we realized is that classroom engineering fundamentals was not enough, that students needed, in addition to that, some sort of global experiences, hands-on experiences, research, broad curriculum that included policy behavior and so on. The Grand Challenge Scholars Program provides those other elements.
What Duke does is they will, you know, they give you the engineering education, and then they give you that little step more, and they say, hey, you should learn about entrepreneurship. Hey, you should learn about social responsibility. Hey, you should learn about economics. So originally, I was on an assessment trip in Uganda, and we noticed that there were a lot of hand pumps that were broken down. I came back to Duke, and I said, okay, well, I'm an engineer. Maybe there's something I can do about this. So I started doing work with Dr. Knight into an improved hand pump system, where the idea is that we would, you know, we would come up with something that was affordable for the communities, that didn't break down as much, and then when it broke down, it would be easier to fix. So right now, I'm currently the co-founder of a company in Uganda that will provide sustainable water and sanitation services to local communities. So our mission is really to provide economically sustainable and reliable water and sanitation service to people that need it most. What the Grand Challenges Scholars Program really did for me was it kind of gave me that more broad sense of, you know, okay, I don't need to just do mechanical engineering for a company. I can use those same principles to do something completely different that could change the world.
Researchers have to really scramble harder and harder than ever before to drive their research forward and to obtain sufficient resources. And what's amazing about Duke Engineering is that we've seen a doubling of the research portfolio in the last 10 years. We've seen an 80% increase in new awards over the last 5 years, which when you look at sort of national trends, that's amazing. And that really speaks to the success, the entrepreneurial spirit, the creativity, and really the overall hard work of the faculty.
Duke has one of the most extensive undergraduate research programs in the country, like the Grand Challenge Scholars Program. And of course, things like the Pratt Fellows, which provide full support for students to work with a faculty member of their choice. About 90% of our undergraduates have had either research or an internship experience.
What I really appreciate about Duke's engineering program is that you have world-leading researchers, but then the fact that you have a small student body allows you to have access to them. When I went to Dr. Steve Roberts, I knew that I had this passion for solar energy, but then I knew very little about what needed to be done in this space. So she has really helped me to get from a point where I have a passion without much substance to being able to do tangible work in that area. In Zimbabwe, around about the time when I was in high school, we had a bad bout of inflation, and one of the first areas to suffer was obviously the power industry. So my Grand Challenge's focus is making solar energy more economical, to work towards solutions that allow people to access energy at a very low cost, in a way that's deployable to a wide range of people. I'm focusing on solar because it's environmentally friendly, and it can be harnessed in a distributed way. I think that will enable people to improve the qualities of their lives, to get better access to education, better health, and to catch up with the rest of the world so the cost comes down. And when the cost comes down, more people can benefit from solar energy and we can start replacing some other traditional forms of energy.
Engineering is an area that touches on so much of the world that we live in. What the interdisciplinary education at Duke gives them is a touch on all of these different intellectual areas that they will encounter going forward as they're actually out there in the real world as engineers.
We have several areas where I would say that Duke Pratt School of Engineering is the thought leader in engineering, and that includes biophotonics and aeroelasticity. In environmental nanotechnology, we have one of the strongest programs in the country. We are perhaps the hotbed of metamaterials research, and that's led to all kinds of interesting applications from satellite communication to cloaking devices.
I think it's recognized that we now have a very strong graduate and research activity in addition to the historically strong undergraduate population, and it's been a great success story.
That, in my mind, is the essence of a university education, which is to have the most outstanding research faculty working with students in a one-on-one experience to teach them how to solve problems that aren't in the book. And that's what Duke Engineering is all about.
Students like to make the world a better place. I think we all do. Pratt is a place that actually gives people a serious chance to learn the engineering you need to know, but then to carry it over to the place where you can make that knowledge pay off.
Without a doubt, our students become leaders. That's our legacy.
We got started on the right tack, and I think we're still going on the right tack.
So now we have a school which is hitting its prime and is making tremendous impact across the broad field of engineering. It has the talent and the vision to be one of the leading schools in the country in the future.